Lecture number 5 on the subject of atomic physics. The same Schrödinger's theory of quantum mechanics. Next questions. First, plausibility argument leading to the Schrödinger equation. Second, Born's interpretation of the wave functions. Third, expectation values. Fourth, the time-independent Schrödinger equation, required properties of the eigen functions. We have presented experimental evidence which shows conclusively that the particles of the macroscopic system move according to the laws of some form of wave motion and not according to the Newtonian laws of motion, albeit by the particles of the macroscopic systems. Thus, a macroscopic particle acts as if certain aspects of the behavior are governed by the behavior of an associated de Broglie wave or wave function. The experiment considered dealt only with simple cases such as free particles or simple harmonic oscillators etc. that can be analyzed with simple procedures involving direct applications of the de Broglie postulate, Planck's postulate, etc. To deal with more complex cases, us need to be able to have a more general procedure that can be used to treat the behavior of the particles of any microscopic system. Schrödinger's theory of quantum mechanics provides us with such a procedure. The theory specifies the laws of wave motion that the particles of any microscopic system obey. This is done by specifying for each system the equation that controls of the behavior of the wave function and also by specifying the connection between the behavior of the wave function and the behavior of the particle. The theory is an extension of the Broglie postulate. Furthermore, there is a close relation between Newton's theory of the motion of particles in microscopic systems. Schrödinger's theory is a generalization that includes Newton's theory as a special case, as a macroscopic limit, much as Einstein's theory of relativity is a generalization that includes Newton's theory as a special case in the low velocity limit. A better comparison can be made between the Schrödinger theory and Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism. The reason for this is that electromagnetic waves behave in a manner which is very analogous to the behavior of the wave functions of the Schrödinger theory. Now, we have seen that the de Broglie postulate provides a fundamental step in the development of Schrödinger's general theory of the behavior of microscopic particles. However, it is only a step. The postulate says the motion of the microscopic particle is governed by the propagation of an associated wave, but the postulate does not tell us how the wave propagates. The postulate does predict successfully the wavelength of the wave inferred from measurement of the diffraction pattern observed in the motion of the particle, but only in cases in which the wavelength is essentially constant. Furthermore, we must have a quantitative relation between the properties of the particle and the properties of the wave function that describes the wave. That is, we must know exactly how the wave governs the particle. We shall first study the equation developed by Erwin Schrödinger in 1925, which tells us the behavior of any wave function of interest. Then we shall study the relation developed by the Max Born in the following way, which connects the behavior of the wave function of the behavior of the associated particle. We shall look at the solution of the Schrödinger equation in a general way, and we shall see how they led very naturally to the quantization of energy and other important phenomena. We can see appreciate some of the problems concerning the applicability of the de Broglie postulate, and also get some class about that will have to be done to remove the problems by considering again the case of the free particle. In this case, we have been successful in doing much with the postulate. Previously, when it was necessary to have a mathematical expression for the wave function, we used a simple sinusoidal traveling wave, such as psi function of xt equals sine 2 multiplied p, open brackets x divided lambda minus nu multiplied t, closed bracket. Or else a wave function formed by adding several simple sinusoidals. The form in 5.1 formula was obtained essentially by quasing, with the quas being based on the fact that the free particle has a linear mean momentum p of constant magnitude, since it is not acted on by a force and therefore it is associated de Broglie wavelength lambda equals h divided p of constant magnitude. Equations 5.1 is just the familiar form of a sinusoidal traveling wave of constant wavelength lambda. It also has a constant frequency nu, which we evaluated from the Einstein relation nu equals e divided h, where e is the total energy of the associated particle. Earlier, the able to extend the use of the wave function, like 5.1, to the case of a particle moving in the circular Bohr orbit by imaging such a sinusoidal vapor about the orbit. But this is possible only because in the circular orbit the magnitude p of the linear momentum remains constant, so that lambda equals h divided p, the Broglie wavelength is also constant, even then, so the particle is acted on by the force. We shall not be able to make such simple extensions to great cases where the linear momentum of the particle is a changing magnitude, and of course the cases are typical of what happens when the particle is acted on by a force. The point is that the de Broglie postulate lambda equals h divided p says the wavelength lambda will change if p changes, but a left wavelength is not even well defined if it changes very rapidly. We illustrate thus this with the non-sinusoidal wave shown in figure 5.1. For this wave, it is difficult to define even a variable wavelength, since the separation between adjusted maxima is not equal to the separation between adjusted minima. To put the point another way, if the linear momentum of a particle is not a constant magnitude because the particle is acted on by a force, functions which are more complicated within the sinusoidal of 5.1 are required to describe the associated wave. We shall need help to find these more complicated wave functions. The Schrödinger equations will provide the required assistance. This is the equation that tells us the form of the wave function, psi function from x and t. If we tell it about the force acting of the associated particle by specifying the potential energy corresponding to the force. In other words, we have function is a solution of the Schrödinger equation for the potential energy. The most common type of the equation, which has a function for a solution, is a differential equation. In fact, the Schrödinger equation is a differential equation. That is, the equation is the relation between its solution psi function from x and t and certain derivatives of psi function x and t with respect to the independent space and the time variables x and t. As there is more than one independent variable, this must be partial derivatives, such as formula 5.2. Example 5.1. Evaluate the partial derivatives listed above of the sinusoidal function 5.1. A partial derivative is a derivative of a function of several independent variables, which is evaluated by allowing one of the variables to vary while holding all of the others temporarily fixed. This is indicated by using a symbol such as partial d c over particle dx instead of the usual symbol for the ordinary derivative partial d c x and t over partial dx. The symbol means, for instance, formula 5.3 and or formula 5.4. Before applying the procedure of the sinusoidal function of phi 5.1, it is convenient to rewrite the term of the quantities k equals 2 multiplied p divided lambda and omega equals 2 multiplied p multiplied nu. We obtain next formula. The partial differentials then will next four differentials, since t can be treated as a constant in the first two differentials, whereas x can be treated as a constant in the last two. The Schrödinger equation is a partial differential equation. We shall in due course study solutions of this equation, and we shall see that it is generally quite easy to decompose it into a set of ordinary differential equations. It has differential equations involving only ordinary derivatives. These ordinary differential equations will then be handled by the application of the Stratford techniques. Plausibility argument leading to the Schrödinger equation. Now the first problem at hand is not how to solve a certain differential equation. Instead, the problem is how to find the equation. That is, we are in the position of the Newton when he has looking for the differential equations. F equals d derivative p over dt equals m multiplied d2 derivative x over partial dx dt, which is the basic equation of classical mechanics or Maxwell when he has looking for the differential equations such as formula 5.7 that form the basis of the classical electromagnetism. The wave equation for the stretched string can be derived by the Newton's law, and the electromagnetic wave equation can be derived from Maxwell's equations, but we cannot expect to be able to derive the quantum mechanical wave equation from any of equations of classical physics. However, we can expect to receive some help from the de Broglie-Einstein postulates. Lambda equals h divided p and nu equals e divided h, which connects the wavelength lambda of the wave function with the linear momentum p of the associated particle, and also connect the frequency nu of the wave function with the total energy e of the particle for the case of the particle with essentially constant p and e. That is, quantum mechanical wave equation we seek must be consistent with these postulates, and we shall use this required consistency on our search. Equations 5.8 plus other, and they shall have reason to the except, will be woven into an argument that is designed to make a quantum mechanical wave equation seem very plausible. But it must be emphasized that the plausibility argument will not constitute a derivation. In the final analysis, the quantum mechanical wave equation will be obtained by a postulate whose justification is not that it had been deduced entirely from the information already known experimentally, but is correctly predicts results which can be verified experimentally. We begin our plausibility argument by listing four reasonable assumptions, concerning the properties of the desired quantum mechanical wave equations. First, it must be consistent with the de Broglie-Einstein postulates 5.8, lambda equals h divided p and mu equals e divided h. Second, it must be consistent with the equation e equals p squared divided 2 multiplied m plus v, formula 5.9, relating the total energy E of the particle and mass m to its kinetic energy p squared divided 2 multiplied m and the potential energy v. 3. It must be linear in psi function from x and t. That is, if psi sub 1 function from x and t and psi sub 2 function from x and t are two different solutions to the equation for a given potential energy V, we shall see that a partial differential equation have many solutions, then any arbitrary linear combination of the solutions psi sub 1 function from x and t equals psi sub 1 multiplied psi sub 1 xt plus psi sub 2 multiplied psi sub 2 xt is also a solution. This combination is said to be linear, that it removes the first linear power of the psi sub 1 xt and psi sub 2 xt. It is said to be arbitrary since the constant c sub 1 and c sub 2 can be have any arbitrary values. This linearity requirement ensures that we shall be able to add together wave functions to produce the constructive and destructive interferences that are so characteristic of waves. Interference phenomena are commonplace by electromagnetic waves. All of the diffraction patterns of physical optics are understood in terms of the addition of the electromagnetic waves. But the Davis and German experiment and others show that the diffraction patterns are also found in the motion of electrons and other particles. Therefore, the wave functions also exhibit interferences, and so that should be capable to being added. 4. The potential energy V is generally a function of x and possibly even t. However, there is an important special case where V function from x and t equals V sub 0, formula 5.10. There is just the case of the three particles, since the force acting on the partial is given by F equals minus partial dV function from x and t over dx, which yields if f equals 0, if v sub 0 is a constant. In this case, Newton's law of motion tells us that the linear momentum p of the particle will be constant. And we also know that its total energy E will be constant. We have here the situation of a free particle with constant values of lambda equals h divided p and mu equals e divided h discussed earlier. The way assume that in this case the desired differential equation will have sinusoidal traveling wave solutions of constant wavelength and frequency, similar to the sinusoidal wave function 5.1. Using the de Broglie-Einstein relations and assumption 1 to write the energy equation of assumption 2 in terms of lambda and mu, we obtain h squared divided 2 multiplied m multiplied lambda squared plus v function of x and t equals h multiplied mu. Before proceeding, it is convenient to introduce the quantities. K equals 2 multiplied. As an example 5.1, they are useful because they keep variables out of the denominators, and because they absorb a factor of 2 multiplied p that will otherwise appear every time we write a sinusoidal wave function. The quantity k is called the wave number. The quantity omega is called the angular frequency. Introducing them, we obtain h bar square multiplied k square divided 2 multiplied m plus v function of x t equals h bar multiplied omega, where h bar equals h divided 2 multiplied p is Planck's constant divided by 2 multiplied p. To satisfy assumptions 1 and 2, the wave equation we seek must be consistent with 5.20. In order to satisfy the linearity assumption 3, it is necessary that every term in the differential equations be linear in psi function from xt. It has to be proportional to the first power of psi function xt. Note that any derivative of psi function xt has this property. For instance, if we consider the change of the magnitude of partial d to psi function from xt over dx, that results if we change the magnitude of psi function xt, say by a factor of c. We see that the derivative increases by the same factor and thus is proportional to the first power of the function. This is true since next formula, where c is any constant. In order that the differential equations itself by linear of psi function from xt, it cannot contain any term which is independent of psi function xt, which is proportional to psi function multiply psi function xt, or which is proportional to psi function xt 2 power or any higher power. After obtaining the equation, we shall demonstrate as explicitly that it is linear to c function xt, and in process the validity of these statements will become apparent. Now let us use this assumption 4, which concerns the form of the free particle solution. As suggested by that assumption, we shall first try to write an equation containing the sinusoidal wave function 5.1 and all derivatives of the wave function. We have already evaluated some of the derivatives of examples 5.1. Inspecting this, we see the effect of the talking the second space derivative is to introduce a factor of minus k square, and the effect of taking the first time derivative is to introduce to factor of minus omega. Since the differential equation we seek must be consistent with 5.20, well, which contains a factor of k square in one term and a factor of omega in another. These facts suggest that the differential equation should contain a second space derivative of psi function xt and a first time derivative of psi function xt. But there must also be a term containing a factor of v function xt, because it is present in 5.12. In order to ensure linearity, the term must contain a factor of psi function xt. Putting all these ideas together, we try the following form of the differential equation. Alpha multiplied partial d psi function xt over dx plus v function xt multiplied psi function xt equals beta multiplied partial d psi function xt over dt. Formula 5.13. The constants alpha and beta have values which remain to be determined. They are used to provide flexibility which we must request will be needed in fitting 5.13 to be various requirements it must satisfy. The form of 5.13 seems reasonable, is general, but will it work in detail? To find out, we consider the case of constant potential. V function xt equals V sub 0 and evaluate psi function xt and its derivatives from 5.1 and 5.5 equations. We obtain immediately formula 5.14. Even so, the constant alpha and beta are at our disposal, we cannot make this agree with 5.12 and thus satisfy assumptions 1.1 and 2nd, except for special combinations of the independent variables x and t, for which sine from k multiplied k minus omega multiplied t equals cosine from k multiplied x minus omega multiplied t. It is true that they could obtain agreement if alpha and beta were not constants, but we reject this possibility in favor of the very much simple one present next. The difficulty of hand arises because differentiation changes cosines and sines and vice versa. This fact suggests that we try using for the free particle wave function, not the single sinusoidal of 5.1, but instead the combination psi function xt equals cosine kxt minus omega t plus gamma multiplied sine kxt minus omega t, where gamma is a constant of a yet undetermined value which is introduced for the purpose of the providing additional flexibility. We hope the find of the proper mixture of the cosine and the sine will remove the difficulty. Evaluating the required derivatives, we find next three formula 5.16. Then we try again substituting 5.15 and 5.16 into the same assumed form 5.13 for the differential equation and setting V function from xt equals V sub 0, we obtain next formula. In order that the last equality hold for all possible combinations of the independent variables x and t, it is necessary that the coefficients of both the cosine and the sine be 0. Thus, we obtain formula 5.17 and 5.18. Now we have a problem that is easily handled. There are three algebraic equations that we must satisfy, 5.12, 5.17 and 5.18, but we have three free constants alpha, beta and gamma at our disposal. Subtracting 5.8 from 5.17, we find 0 equals minus beta multiplied gamma multiplied omega minus beta multiplied omega divided gamma, or gamma equals minus 1 divided gamma, so that gamma square equals minus 1, or gamma plus and minus square root from minus 1 equals plus and minus e, where e is an imaginary number. Substituting this result into 5.17, we find minus alpha multiplied k square plus v sub 0 equals minus and plus I multiplied beta multiplied omega. This can be compared directly with 5.12 x bar square multiplied k square divided 2 multiplied m plus v sub 0 equals h bar multiplied omega to wield alpha equals minus h bar square divided 2 multiplied m, and minus and plus I multiplied beta equals h bar, or beta equals minus and plus, plus and minus I multiplied h bar. Formula 5.21. There are two possible choices on the scene of the in 5.19. It turns out to be of no significant consequence which choice is made, and therefore we follow conventional usage and choose the plus sign. Then 5.21 wills beta equals plus I multiplied h bar, and with 5.20 we finally can evaluate all of the constants in the assumed form of the differential equation. Thus 5.13 becomes formula 5.22. The differential equation satisfies all four of our assumptions concerning the quantum mechanical wave equation. It should be emphasized that we have been led to 5.22 by treating a special case, the case of free particle where v function from xt equals v sub 0, a constant. At this point, it seems plausible to argue that the quantum mechanical wave equations might be expected to have the same form as 5.22 in the general case where the potential energy v function from xt does actually vary as a function of x and or t, it was where the force is not zero. But we cannot prove this to be true. We can, however, postulate it to be true. We do this and therefore take 5.22 as the quantum mechanical wave equations whose solutions ψ function from xt give us the same wave function which is to be associated with the motion of a particle of mass m under the influence of forces which are described by the potential energy function v function xt. The validity of the postulate must be judged by the comparing with implications with experiment, and we shall make many such comparisons later. Equation 5.22 was first obtained in 1926 by Erwin Schrödinger, and it is therefore called the Schrödinger equation. Schrödinger was led to his equation by argument different from ours and more esoteric. However, he has been strongly influenced by the de Broglie postulate in his work, as we have been in ours. It should be pointed out that we cannot expect the Schrödinger equation to be valid when they apply it to particles moving at relativistic velocities. This is the case because the equation has been designed to be consistent with 5.9, the classical energy equation, which is incorrect for velocities comparable to the velocity of light. In 1928, Dirac developed a relativistic theory of quantum mechanics utilizing essentially the same postulates as the Schrödinger theory, except that 5.9 was replaced by the relativistic analogy.